Every IT project manager needs to know Kanban. And on the surface, Kanban is simply a board with tasks. But there are many critical productivity concepts hidden under the hood. But the internet can give you only high-level information, so you will have to master Kanban through trial and error yourself. That's why I'm going to share my refined practical experience of using Kanban in the IT industry. And you need to stay until the end because I'll address most common challenges related to Kanban implementation in the real world, and we'll talk about it at the end of the video. Let's start with the critical element of Kanban, the board. But before you skip this section, let me warn you, it's easy to screw this up, especially in IT project management. First of all, your board should transparently visualize all the work. Then the board should include all critical stages a task gets through from start to finish. But at the same time, you don't want to overload the board by going too granular. For example, the simplest board looks like to-do in progress done. But for most IT projects, it's not enough. So for example, at the very least, you want to include a code review before finishing a development task. But then, what about business analysis and quality assurance? And where should go the UI UX designs and so on? And now your workflow may look like this. To-do, business analysis, UI design, in progress, QA, done. But there might be even more stages in your process, and soon your board will become unusable. To overcome this problem, you need to group stages and identify the definitions of done for each column. Let me give you some examples. So you may not want to track business analysis and UI design on the board. In this case, you may agree with the team that tickets should be fully ready for development before you move them from backlog into the first to-do column. Here's another example. What does the done stage mean? Does it mean the task is finished and the code is merged into the main branch? Or does it mean that the new code is already in production environment and customers can use new functionality? So all such details should be described in the definition of done for each column. And here's a practical way to develop a perfect Kanban board. So you start by listing all the stages of your workflow. Then you list the definitions of done for each column. And finally, you review the whole workflow and see where you can group stages into one column. By the way, you must do this exercise together with your team. They can help you find gaps in the process or things they do differently in the real world. At the end of the video, we'll discuss several other critical considerations about the board. But right now, we'll discuss what makes Kanban a productivity tool. You see, if you just create a board and start moving tickets on it, it will quickly become a total mess. Urgent requests will appear, and people will start working on several tasks in parallel. Some will forget to move a ticket through the workflow, or some tasks will be blocked for some reason. And there is one elegant solution to address all those problems. It is work in progress limits. So each column on your Kanban board should limit the number of tasks that can be present in that column at the same time. The rule of thumb is to have WIP or work in progress limit as low as possible. You can imagine the most efficient workflow when a chain of people handles buckets of water. So each person does only one action at their spot. Now imagine if you start passing two buckets simultaneously. It's still feasible, but people will get tired and productivity will drop. And if you try to give them three buckets at once, the chain will stop working. So in Kanban, we need to adjust work in progress limits for different columns to achieve the best possible performance. At the same time, a combination of defined workflow and correct work-in-progress limits will encourage your team to get things done from start to finish. By the way, I mentioned the team and you in the Kanban process, but in fact, a team is not specified in the Kanban framework. But it's a critical aspect and we'll also discuss it later in this video, so stick with me. And if you find this video useful, please hit the like button, because it will help me reach more people and it will be a great inspiration to produce more videos on IT project management. Thank you in advance. Now let me show you how Kanban and work in progress limits work in practice. So, for example, we have two software engineers and one quality assurance engineer. In this workflow, it makes sense to put work in progress limits to 2 in all columns. At the start of the project, developers will take 2 tasks from the to-do and move them into the in-progress column. First, they will write code, and then, for example, the first developer finishes his task. Finally, he pushes it to the peer review. This developer can start working on a new task. Notice what happens behind the scene. Each developer has no more than 2 tasks to focus on. Yes, it's still a switch of context, but it's always limited to 2 things only, so it's easy to plan your day and switch context when it has less impact on your productivity. But it's even better. We'll get to the situation when we have 2 tasks in the in-progress and 2 tasks in the peer review columns. Now the system starts to self-regulate based on the work-in-progress limits that we set. For example, a developer finishes a task in the in-progress column, but he cannot move it to the peer review column because we are at the WIP limit. He also cannot take a new task from the to-do column and move it to in-progress column because it's also at the WIP limit. Instead, this developer has to take the task from the peer review column and perform the review and push it to the in-QA column. As you can see, it forces people to get things done. Also, you'll likely find defects when tasks get into the QA column, so they will also pile up there and will force developers to fix defects before they can start a new task. So the whole idea of Kanban is that you hit a bottleneck in the workflow and now you need to work as a team to find and remove this roadblock. But here's what I want you to understand. There are no other tools or processes prescribed by Kanban that can help you avoid these bottlenecks. You and your team must develop an efficient workflow empirically, which means by observing or experience rather than theory or pure logic. And there is no such thing as perfect Kanban at the start of a project. So first, it's all about eliminating bottlenecks, and second, you need to improve efficiency of your workflow all the time. Yeah, some technology may help you here, and we'll talk about it later in this video. But now here's what's even more important. When we have a bottleneck, it's obvious you need to deal with it, but how can you track and improve the efficiency of your Kanban workflow when tasks don't pile up in the columns and everything looks streamlined? Most software applications with Kanban boards have the following charts: Cumulative Flow Diagram and Control Chart. The Cumulative Flow Diagram shows historical data on how many tasks you had in each state at a given date. It packs so much information. For example, the number of tasks you finished. You can see bottlenecks on the chart. And also you can identify the lead time of a task. And the control chart or cycle chart shows you the average and actual time it took for a ticket to get through the workflow. So keep an eye on these charts whenever you change something in the Kanban workflow. It's the best way to see the impact of those changes. But keep in mind that every system has inertia, so it may take some time to see the actual effect of the change, and it may take some time for the system to stabilize itself. Okay, but these charts require 2 separate videos to explain them in detail. And I think it's a bit beyond the beginner's guide, so I'll leave you some resources in the description below this video. Meanwhile, we covered the theory of Kanban, but it's not enough to implement it on an IT project. Let's move to practical tips and address common questions and challenges. Can you run the whole project with Kanban alone? Yes and no. You see, the Kanban board describes only one continuous workflow, and usually it's a project execution workflow, like software development process. In the real world, you'll need to have separate Kanban boards for different activities. So you'll need to consider actual workflows and processes in your organization and build Kanban workflows around them. But what about lean Kanban approaches? They describe the development process end-to-end. It's more of an exception in the real world. However, this approach will work if you meet the following requirements. You have a small and independent organization, so the team can make all the decisions. The whole software development process fits into the Kanban workflow. It boils down to not having dependencies on external resources and stakeholders. You have continuous integration and continuous delivery infrastructure in place. And if you are interested in this topic of CI/CDs, let me know in the comments below. If you meet all these criteria, you can run the whole project with Kanban alone. But usually teams evolve and mature to that state, so it's unlikely you can build this process from scratch on day one. Do you have meetings and ceremonies like in Scrum? The Kanban approach does not prescribe meetings and ceremonies, but it implies that you can introduce some routines. You see, Kanban is a continuous process, it never stops. However, in the real world, it's very hard to build a process allowing you to deliver each separate task directly to the end users. Instead, you set up a cadence to deliver results of your work to the customers. Therefore, you can decide to have a demo every 2 weeks and release a new product version afterwards. But for example, you will have retrospective meetings and backlog groomings every week. So this cadence is a superstructure of your main Kanban workflow. Do you have roles in Kanban? Or specifically, do you have a sort of Scrum Master there? Kanban doesn't specify any roles at all, so you can use it with any team in any industry. I think that the only implied requirement is that your team should be able to handle all the work required to finish a task from start to finish. However, you also need someone responsible for prioritization of the backlog. Should I keep a backlog on the Kanban board? Again, it's up to you. In pure Kanban, there is no such thing as a separate backlog. Everything starts and ends on the board. I prefer to hide the backlog. This way, the team won't be distracted by numerous tasks that sit on the board, so they can focus on tasks I already prioritized for them. Do you have estimates in Kanban? There are no estimates in Kanban. Instead, you predict when a specific task is done by prioritization and the lead time. The lead time is the time it takes to get a task from start to finish. Nevertheless, Kanban is super flexible. For example, you can break down deliverables into tasks and perform estimations outside of the Kanban process. Then you'll feed in estimated tasks on your board. What are the most common mistakes a new team makes while adopting Kanban? Teams often create columns on the board where tasks are idling in the middle of the workflow. In other words, they have multiple to-do columns where tasks can wait. For example, if you have a column that starts with waiting for, that's a bad sign. Ideally, you should have a workflow that encourages you to finish tasks as soon as possible. Second most common mistake is not using work in progress limits. Without WIPs, a Kanban board is just a fancy way of visualizing statuses of the tasks. What is the best way to optimize lead time for a new team? The best way to make Kanban more efficient for a new or experienced team is to make tasks approximately the same size. The rule of thumb is to create tasks with no more than 3 to 5 days worth of effort. It will help to eliminate lots of bottlenecks, it will make reporting more meaningful, and you will quickly notice the effects of your changes on the workflow. What are the main technical aspects of Kanban implementation in the IT industry? When you start using Kanban, it's just a board and tasks. You can use Trello, Jira, Azure DevOps, or any other tool. But if you have a lot of other manual processes outside of the Kanban board, you lose productivity benefits of this approach. That's why you need to investigate the capabilities of your tool. Search for ways to automate and integrate other processes. Things like creating a new build when a task gets into the done column, running automated tests, and sending notifications about a new stable build or failed tests. In the IT industry, all of this helps you to improve your Kanban workflow. And yes, you need to persuade your customers to invest time into these activities. How do you assure quality in Kanban? Kanban demands that you create quality products, so you don't create defects or bug tickets to fix later. Instead, you deal with these issues before a task gets to the done state. That's exactly why investing time in automated testing and continuous integration will help you deliver more value faster. But there is one more critical thing. As an IT project manager, you will never use only Kanban. Instead, it will be a part of a bigger project management approach. That's why I strongly recommend you watching this full project management tutorial next. It will help you understand where to plug in the Kanban workflow and what other processes you might need before and after it. Click the video now and we'll continue our conversation there. Thank you in advance. See you there.